Hi, I'm Saul Ramirez. I'm an artist, art historian, and a poet. I am based in Las Cruces, New Mexico, and El Paso area. I was born in El Paso, and I grew up in Juarez, Albuquerque, and ended up here in Las Cruces, and have been living here, working on my practice since I studied here at the local university, NMSU. And now I just work mostly from my home. This is my little studio space where I mostly paint, write, and study. My cultural practice has been very fluid for a long time now, and describing it has always been a little hard, just because I've a big part of my practice is always finding new things to do and always finding new ways to express things, really. And so my practice began with painting. That's really where like my art life began. But throughout my journey in college, especially, I tried to become a physics student, and I was really into astronomy for a long time. And so I spent a lot of about 2 years at least, just focused as thinking I was going to become an astronomer. And then after that, I went and started focusing on art history specifically, and sort of became very interested in the writing aspect. And so slowly throughout my practice, I just sort of been trying to flesh out the things that I care about in a very practical way. So it's a lot about and that's why I really do think, for me, my practice has really just been about engaging anything and everything, and finding my own connection with it. I think the whole world is made out of art, in a sense, and every practice has its art and has its part that is, the way I like to say it is, everything has its art and everything has its science and everything has its sort of way of being engaged. And so there was a period of time last year that I was engaging a lot, and I still am, with certain little local city politics and stuff, because I think that that's also an artistic practice on its own, and it can be done beautifully as well as anything else, and it should be. But it is, for my practice, always just kind of about experimenting and sort of bringing what I know from other things into new places that would otherwise not really consider those things. I really care a lot about, I've always really thought it was interesting how artists and scientists have always thought of themselves as so different at a cultural level. They don't really mingle and mix, especially in the schools. And so by the time I was making art in at NMSU a lot, there was a lot of that art was about the things I learned in my science classes and in my physics classes. And so I realized at a very early point back then that there's always interchange between disciplines. And so at some level, the hardest part of my practice has always been sort of summing it up into a simple thing that I can do as a job, right? It's been really hard to turn it into a actual single job, but it's been fruitful in all the different sort of things it's allowed me to actually engage. Yeah. My work, I feel like for a long time, I had a very, my practice, I didn't realize how connected it was to my environment for a long time. And I think this is true about a lot of modern realities, I think, in general, is how, you know, this detached we become from things. And I do remember as a young child, right, like, I moved from Juarez. We moved to Kansas first. We were there for a few months before we moved to Albuquerque. And we in Albuquerque, we had, like, three or four different places that we lived, different apartments we kept moving. For a while, we had a house. And then, you know, the market crashed, and we ended up having to move over to El Paso right after that in 2008. And it was this whole feeling like I didn't have a home for a long time. Like, I didn't have, like, I didn't feel at home, right? Like, everywhere was a new place, new friends, new environment, in a sense. And it really, I remember it was in, I think it was 2017 with the school at NMSU. We got to go to Europe, and it was really fun. And after being there and seeing these, like, different landscapes, you know, especially landscapes that I, cultural landscapes, right, that I had been engaging with in the university classroom for a long time, especially because, you know, sadly, it's still the case that European standards is what is specifically taught. But when I went to Europe and sort of recognized the everything I had been learning at NMSU, I like kind of seeing it in its context, kind of seeing it in this in its place, right? It really made me look at myself and see myself back in my place, right? It really, like every time I looked at my art, I saw distinctly my home, right? Because it was no longer just these things I was trying to import from other places, like all this knowledge. And that's usually how it works with the university. You have to, like, take in all these global issues. But it took me a long time to really feel connected, right, and connected to the landscape. But I do remember back when I first started writing poetry, all of my poems at first were being written from the perspective of like a desert saint monk who goes out into a wilderness and hides out and sort of like communes with God or whatever, communes with the universe. And a lot of that poetry, you know, especially looking back at it, really was about that sense of loving your desert home, and then your desert home feeling like it loves you back, but it's always a very conflicted love. It's a, a struggling love, right? And I think that that's one of the things that I think the desert has really taught me. Like, the desert has really become a part of my practice and the way that I sort of have to, it's like, I would say it's like an act of perseverance, right? Every artwork, every next piece that I work on, or every next project becomes an act of survival. And I think that's also part of, like, where the practice is always changing, because, like, I think survival requires that kind of change, that kind of, like, adaptation. And it's me trying to survive to, like, the changing times and saying, like, well, it's not enough to make just a pretty painting. I think I need to adapt to the world, give myself the space to be able to be different, right, in different places. And I think it took me a while to also realize that I'm not the only one in this landscape who has experienced having to leave their home and transplant and, you know, losing parents. And that whole process became a narrative that I connected to here in my landscape, and sort of it really brought me back home, and it really put me in a place to start to try to, you know, get involved in civic politics, for one, right? Like, getting involved in the art board and being a part of NAMI here in town, nonprofit organizations. It really sort of changed my perspective about what art could be, and it really changed, like, my idea about how I want my own city to feel like art. I want my own city to feel like a home in a way that maybe my generation and generation before has never got the chance to, you know, because I feel like one of the things I learned after I came back from Europe especially is how much of our environment has been transformed by that European idea, and how much of that has been has forced us to detach ourselves from our own home while we're still here. You know, like, it doesn't take a lot to I can't think of the word, but get alienated, that's the word, maybe, to alienate yourself from your own home. It doesn't take a lot. It's almost like our own city government does that for us, you know? And I don't know, there's something, it's like, it's hard to appreciate your desert home here. And I think our growing up, people, you know, kids around me, they weren't given, how would I say, like, a way to appreciate where they lived. You know, they're always told to leave. They're always told to go find that there's work elsewhere. You know, if you stay tied to this land, you're not gonna make it, basically. You know, and there's always something really sad about that. And I think, like, my goal has always been to give back that life and that care. And I also think that's part of why we abuse these landscapes, is because we don't value them the way that we should. We see a desert and we see lifelessness instead of actually the sort of beautiful survival that it provides. You know, there's life, you know, in the desert. It's not just along the river, you know, like, the whole desert can provide everything you need to survive, you know. And I think, like, one of the main things I try to do always is just look at my little landscape, at my little world that has been abused by how people see it. You know, people have just see it as a quick buck, it feels, the whole landscape of Paso Juarez. Yeah. I'll say that's the harder one to answer, just because it feels like, in terms of what I'm doing, you know, that's always how it's put, even, I think, with, like, my generation. It's like, we're, like, first generation to go to school, college. I'm the first in my family to graduate from the university. And, you know, it's been very, how would I say, alienating too, I guess you could say. You know, I feel like something that my practice has, you know, I wouldn't say it's like because of my practice, but I've, like, noticed it in my practice, and I've noticed it in my life in general, is that I live very separate from my family, and I sort of feels like our family relations, whatever our family used to be, has disentangled, you know, and it's hard. It feels like, you know, I think in this kind of society, in this life, in this modern society now, it's hard to stay in touch with people in certain ways. But then looking back at, like, what has happened to, like, the home where our family used to live in Juarez, right? Like, thinking about, like, how we all used to be there, you know, when I was a kid, we were all still at my grandma's and my grandpa's, and it was the whole family, you know, coming and going here and there. It was like, I don't know, it was easy, is what I would describe it as. It was easy to be around the family. And then now it's like, I'm in Las Cruces, which isn't that far, right, from El Paso and Juarez, but I never see them, and I never really talk to them, right? They don't, they've never been involved in sort of like my life, really, in that way, you know. And it's not like they don't want to, it's mostly kind of they can't at some level, you know, like there's an aspect of it where they don't they're too caught up in their own lives, in their own sort of survival. And, you know, what I do, I recognize, is also hard to explain. And so my family was never involved, right? Like, they don't go to my art shows, they don't go to my poetry shows. And, you know, like, I see how my mom tries these days so much more to be involved in all these ways, and that's beautiful and great. But I recognize that it's all new work. It's all new to her, too. This is things that she didn't have to deal with when she was younger. You know, family was family and was there physically available. And now it's kind of like making that phone call is even hard. You know, it's kind of like, yeah, the force that was there before to keep the family together. It's like now it's, I have to force myself, right? Like, I have to reproduce, I don't know, out of like this faint memory from when I was a kid, like what family felt like. And but yeah, it all feels like new work, especially because it's a new world. It's like a new kind of like way of having a family and of living a life. And it's all, you know, like, I would like to, how would I say, include my grandparents more. And there's been an effort on my end a little bit to try to like learn those stories. But, you know, there's always a difficulty of like the fact that like our own family doesn't, how would I say, they say what they want to say, right? Like, they won't always share every part of their lives. And I've had to learn how to like respect the silence that our families keep, you know. And I've had to be like, okay, well, you know, some things are not up to me. Some connections are not up to me. And I can recognize how, you know, like, there's things that are like the things that our grandparents gave us, you know, what they lived their whole life to sort of provide for us, for my mom, and then my mom to me and my brother. It's very, it's like complex, right? Like, they, you choose what you want to pass on, but it doesn't mean that what you pass on is going to be useful or stick around, or like, it doesn't mean they're going to need it once you pass it on. And, you know, like, I think that's probably one of the most difficult parts of like this sort of cultural work too, is like trying to think about like culture as something we preserve and something that we like carry on, but also understanding that like culture changes, and like at a material level, like culture doesn't stay the same. And so, you know, it has that really asking like, what is it that we're preserving? And you know, like, why are we preserving it? You know, like, there's a lot of things that are for sentimental reasons we'll preserve. And I think that's, you know, beautiful too, but I also think that that's not always the best. That's that's not how we can like move forward, right? If we, yeah, sentimentality. But, you know, that's like all art. Like, you have to, that's a struggle, carrying the sentimentality and not becoming like trapped by it, trapped by the past, you know, as it was. So like during the fellowship, I did a lot of wonderful research on Las Cruces and El Paso area. And so what I mostly did is actually collect documentation while I was doing a lot of other essay writing about art history and stuff. I started collecting just, I guess, resources about the Southwest. I'm trying to think exactly where it started, where it went. Yes, I had this really cute one here. It's a history survey of Las Cruces, of like, it's like a survey of the architecture. And so it has really, really wonderful pictures of like old buildings from Las Cruces historical buildings. And it like tells you the whole story. It has like awesome maps of like the city designing and documentation. And this is actually the book that got me really interested in like civics for the first time, like in the specifically Las Cruces stuff, that like really pushed me to try to learn about that kind of stuff. And it all happened while I was in the art board. And I got this at COAS. It's like a little collectible book. It was actually kind of expensive because they actually knew it was worth something. Sadly, I could have gotten it. But then I started finding a lot of wonderful, like, some historic maps. Like, there's a cool little collection that we found at COAS. And it's a nice little map of the new world that I really, really thought was quite beautiful. And so I've just been thinking a lot about, so, like, the main aspects of these early, like, collecting, like, documents and stuff was really about, like, asking the question, like, how do we see the Southwest and how do I see my local, how are we looked at? And so what I really think is interesting is finding a lot of these really cool little of El Segundo Barrio, right? Like, that are like published research, and it's just kind of, you can tell this was not widely circulated, you know, like I love that I find these in COAS too, right? Because like signed by the guy who like did the research on here, and it's like there's something so intimate about these documents, and it's and learning about like the little stories, like look at these beautiful little maps of El Paisano. Anyway, old land grants, and I was thinking a lot about land grants again. That's kind of like a big part of the whole research, right? Like I was thinking, how was this land acquired? How is it depicted, you know, at the legal level? That was like a big important question. And I found this really cool book once called The Role of the Land Grant. And it's like a whole book about New Mexico land grants, like the history of like how land grants were used to set up towns here. And this is the, case study of one specific town that's used to sort of talk about the general. And it's kind of great because it's also signed by the guy. And he left a little note in here. A little card with a little signature of his little name, and I'm like, love it. I'm just obsessed with it. But yeah, I spent a lot of time reading about these little land grants and using these little maps and concepts that these guys were teaching to sort of think about the current state of the cities and the current state of like bureaucracy even, and try to think about like the different ways in which, well, like one of the big things while I was in the art board was that was really bothering me is how do people justify development projects in cities, like how easy it is for some people to get a whole new highway built while for most of us we can't even like get the proper paperwork to, I don't know, have a garden or something. You know, like people like there's like a an imbalance in that kind of access. And so while I was hanging out in COAS and just sort of doing this research, like it became really important to me to sort of have an idea as to like how these processes are done on paper, right? I don't know, it's still a very dense process, but I think collecting interesting little archives and documentations of my little desert is like one way to start, right? Like I think like as a collection, this already is a testament to like to this place, right? And to like the history. And there's actually a really cool, maybe it's right here, this is a library book, but there's a very important book I've been reading for a while. It's called Dust. It's the Archives and Cultural History, and it's a this book is a lot about the nature, of course, of archives, and Carolyn Steedman talks a lot about the archon, or like, you know, it's like the sort of Greek word for the person who reads the archives, and how powerful that role is. To be able to read an archive and tell a story from it is basically how cities are made, right? It's really how civilizations are run. And there's something very powerful about trying to, I think, about trying to collect a local archive of like a place to make a testament to like a reality that is here that our own, you know, local community rarely has access to seeing, right? That they rarely have access to, not just like having access to it, but in a sort of curated way that tells them this is your home, right? Because like another, I think, problem with documentation and stuff is that if it's not properly organized, it's not really accessible. You know, like if it's scattered all over the place, it's really hard to like make that picture, I guess. Anyways, and I've always thought there's like this big challenge to making a picture of my local environment, and it's a challenge when we don't really know the local histories. They're not very well told, they're not very well preserved. The paintings are a fun part of the work. They're usually much more, how would I say, ambiguous, usually, what I'm doing with it. It's very much like I let the canvases sort of do things for me. So I really like these up here right now. They're like, I'm really like sort of been thinking about, get some better light on that. You know, about the differences between like the space and surface, and thinking about like, I really like writing, you know, and so I think a lot about like how you scribble something on a surface versus like the way that paint, once you put it on the canvas, it creates a sense of like space, and it's not just something you can really write with. I don't know, there's something interesting. So like if you look at this one over here, that's one where like I've been, where like a lot of that scribbling and paint movement and sort of like body questions come to a head there, where it's like and I think that's like a question that I ask myself a lot. It's like, how do you write space? How do you make like space legible, written? And a lot of it becomes like questions about gesture. And so like this one here, like that's something I like think a lot about the way that little gestures become legible as something else, as like a body, as a room, as a space. And so how would I say, it's like a very fluid process, always sort of changing for me. Sometimes I'm more interested in the rigidity of a architecture, like this one, where I think I'm thinking about like an actual internal space, versus one that's like this one here that I think is more symbolic, I would say, like of like the way that like there's just a figure sort of pictorially in a very simplified non-space, I guess. Because like that one, like I think what was so much more about the child and like what the child is, and you know, the sort of sense of it's actually a copy of another piece by Picasso. Picasso painted a picture of his son like this, and then I took that same sort of image and sort of made a big one like this of it, like with different, kind of like a different approach. Yeah, it was just a lot about like thinking about being a boy, thinking about like the simplicity of the act of writing. Again, you know, this little boy writing. A lot about that process of like that material engagement, I guess you would say, like the way the hands are on the paper, the way that like one sits on their little space to sort of like become who you are, I guess, right? Like thinking about little desert monks in little caves, sort of going off and meditating, right? And I don't know, meditation is also a big part of how I think of all this. Like it's like a meditative practice to meditate on the books, and then meditate on the pictures, and sort of like bounce back and forth between the sort of almost contradictory things. Very like at a meaning level, it's hard to understand how it all comes together, but you know, it's what keeps me, it's what keeps me going, you know, keeping it's that little tension that keeps me yeah, up.